We went deeper into the market, nearer the temple, and the police presence grew heavy. Tonight, especially, was a night when passions would run high, and the ecstasies of faith would merge with the very real intoxication of bhang, a cannabis derivative drunk in milk at this time of the year. Tonight was one of four nights in the year when the temple was open all night, and we were about to witness a Raj Puja, or royal ceremony. The crush intensified. Arms reached out from the wall of humanity for a little turmeric, sandalwood paste, or scented oil. All these things had touched the linga and were sacred by association. The song of the priests was reaching its crescendo within the sanctum. Bells were crashing inside. I glimpsed an eruption of white light and fire. I could taste and smell the colors. The mouth of the inner sanctum was blocked with human bodies. The tempo quickened. Sudden eruptions of red appeared through the temple. We were all covered in powder. It was part carnival, part riot. Then I saw something that captured the breakdown of boundaries that I had sensed was imminent earlier. A policeman, who moments before had been patrolling the precincts of the temple, was swept up in the ecstasy. His olive-green uniform was covered in red. His eyes were rheumy from bhang, and using that same government-issue microphone into which he had been barking orders a moment before, he now bellowed a primal invocation to Shiva. I am, yet what I am none cares or knows. My friends forsake me like a memory lost. I am the self-consumer of my woes. They rise and vanish in oblivious host. Like shadows in love's frenzied, stifled throes. And yet I am and live. Like vapors tossed into the nothingness of scorn and noise. Into the living sea of waking dreams, where there is neither sense of life or joys, but the vast shipwreck of my life's esteems. Even the dearest that I loved the best are strange, nay, rather stranger than the rest. I long for scenes where man hath never trod, a place where woman never smiled or wept, there to abide with my creator, God, and sleep as I in childhood sweetly slept, untroubling and untroubled where I lie, the grass below, above the vaulted sky. What is stronger than the human heart, which shatters over and over and still lives? Not from this anger. Anticlimax, after refusal, struck her loin, and the lame flower bent like a beast to lap the singular floods in a land strapped by hunger. Shall she receive a bellyful of weeds and bear those tendril hands I touch across the agonized two seas? Behind my head a square of sky sags over, the circular smile tossed from lover to lover, and the golden ball spins out of the skies. Not from this anger, after refusal struck like a bell underwater, shall her smile breed that mouth behind the mirror, that burns along my eyes. Mr. Twit was one of these very hairy-faced men. The whole of his face, except for his forehead, his eyes and his nose, was covered with thick hair. The stuff even sprouted in revolting tufts out of his nostrils and ear holes. And how often did Mr. Twit wash this bristly, nail-brushy face of his? The answer is never, not even on Sundays. Watch carefully next time you see a hairy man eating his lunch, and you will notice that even if he opens his mouth very wide, it is impossible for him to get a spoonful of beef stew or ice cream and chocolate sauce into it without leaving some of it on the hairs. Mr. Twit didn't even bother to open his mouth wide when he ate. As a result, and because he never washed, there were always hundreds of bits of old breakfast and lunches and suppers sticking to the hairs around his face. They weren't big bits, mind you, because he used to wipe those off with the back of his hand or on his sleeve while he was eating. But if you look closely, not that you'd ever want to, you would see tiny little specks of dried up scrambled eggs stuck to the hairs, and spinach and tomato ketchup and fish fingers and minced chicken livers and all the other disgusting things Mr. Twit liked to eat. If you look closer still, hold your noses, ladies and gentlemen. If you peered deep into the moustachey bristles sticking out over his upper lip, you would probably see much larger objects that had escaped the wipe of his hand, things that had been there for months and months, like a piece of maggoty green cheese or mouldy old cornflake, or even the slimy tail of a tin sardine. I'm afraid. I'm so afraid. The cold, black fear is clutching me tonight. As long ago, when they would take the light and leave the little child who would have prayed, frozen and sleepless at the thought of death. My heart that beats too fast will rest too soon. I shall not know if it be night or noon. Yet shall I struggle in the dark for breath? Will no one fight the terror for my sake, the heavy darkness that no dawn will break? How can they leave me in the dark alone, who loved the joy of light and warmth so much, and thrilled so with the sense of sound and touch? How can they shut me underneath a stone? There is an idea of Patrick Bateman, some kind of abstraction. But there is no real me, only an entity, something illusory. And though I can hide my cold gaze and you can shake my hand and feel flesh gripping yours, and maybe you can even sense our lifestyles are probably comparable, I simply am not there. It is hard for me to make sense on any given level. Myself is fabricated, an aberration. I am a non-contingent human being. My personality is sketchy and unformed. My heartlessness goes deep and is persistent. My conscience, my pity, my hopes disappeared a long time ago, probably at Harvard, if they ever did exist. There are no more barriers to cross. All I have in common with the uncontrollable and the insane, the vicious and the evil, all the mayhem I have caused and my utter indifference toward it, I have now surpassed. My pain is constant and sharp, and I do not hope for a better world for anyone. In fact, I want my pain to be inflicted on others. I want no one to escape. But even after admitting this, And I have countless times in just about every act I've committed and coming face to face with these truths. There is no catharsis. I gain no deeper knowledge about myself. No new understanding can be extracted from my telling. There has been no reason for me to tell you any of this. My confession has meant nothing. The year is divided up into four parts: spring, summer, harvest, and winter. And four fasts need to be observed according to these seasons, to thrust away whichever of the four humors has dominion over man's body during that time. Namely, blood in spring, choler in summer, melancholy in autumn, and phlegm in winter. And therefore we fast in spring, that the blood of concupiscence and excessive gladness be made feeble in us. For the man that is made up of too much blood is lecherous and glad. In summer we fast so that the choler of wrath and deception be made feeble in us. For the choleric man is naturally wrathful with hateful thoughts and deceitful. In autumn we fast so that the melancholy of envy and dejection should be made feeble in us. For the melancholy man is by nature cold, envious, and downcast. And finally, we fast in winter so that the phlegm of dullness and sluggishness should be cast down. For the phlegmatic man is naturally dull and slow.